Welcome back to our list of the top 10 retired steam excursion stars. This final part covers 5 honorable mentions, so sit back, relax, and enjoy the show. Number 5, Grand Trunk Western number 4070. This mighty USRA light Mikado was built in 1918 by the American Locomotive Company of Schenectady, New York, originally numbered as 3734 and changed to 4070 in 1957. She ran on the Grand Trunk Western until March of 1960 and was retired from service shortly thereafter. She sat cold for nearly 6 years in Michigan until 1966, when she was leased by the Midwest Railway Preservation Society and thus began her new role as a public relations ambassador and teaching tool for American railroads. In the 1960s and 1970s, she could be found poling excursions all over the eastern United States, from Chicago to Pennsylvania, including a 1977 doubleheader over Horseshoe Curve with Reading T1 number 2102. In 1971, the 4070 was fully bought by the Midwest Railway Preservation Society, and it legally became their property. Beginning in 1975, the locomotive began running excursions over the newly formed Cuyahoga Valley Line between Cleveland and Akron, Ohio. In 1984, the 4070 was painted as a Chicago, Burlington, and Quincy locomotive for the filming of the movie The Natural, starring Robert Redford. Following the movie, she continued pulling excursions on the Valley Line, attracting people from all over the country to the newly formed national park. But soon after, troubles were to arise. Following the 1989 season, there were found to be mechanical issues with the locomotive, which were deemed cost prohibitive, so the locomotive was sidelined from service in 1990, after 24 years of excursion service. In 2014, work began to return the locomotive to service at the Society's ex-B&O Roundhouse in the flats of Cleveland, Ohio. The cost of the restoration is estimated to be $1.29 million. It could still take up to 2 years to complete if all the money was available. In addition, the Society has limited space in the roundhouse to work on the locomotive, with one of the stalls being loaned out to the American Steam Railroad with Reading T1 number 2100, and the roof above 5 of the roundhouse stalls having collapsed some years ago. In some cases, the work on the 4070 has to be performed outside, which is no easy task during Lake Erie's brutal winters. Therefore, it will likely be a few years before the 4070 steams again. Number 4, St. Louis Southwestern number 819. This giant northern type was built by the railroad's own Pine Bluff shops in Arkansas in 1943 and has the distinction of being the last locomotive built by the St. Louis Southwestern, better known as the Cotton Belt Route. The locomotive traveled over 800,000 miles during her 10 and a half years in service, being retired in late 1953. In July of 1955, the locomotive was presented to the city of Pine Bluff and placed on display in Townsend Park. In the fall of 1960, the locomotive was relocated to Oakland Park, where she sat for another 23 years. The elements and vandals took their toll on the old iron horse during this time, and by 1983, the Big Northern had become a mere shell of her former self. Fortunately, this was about to change for the better. On December 1st, 1983, the 819 touched Cotton Belt rails for the first time in nearly 3 decades. The reason? The 819 was about to undergo a restoration to operating condition at the exact same place she was built, the Pine Bluff Shops. The restoration was an all-volunteer effort led by the Arkansas Railroad Club and the Cotton Belt Rail Historical Society, and nicknamed Project 819. During her restoration, many parts that had been stolen during her time in the park were returned, including the whistle and one of the emblems on the side of the cylinder. Over 3 years and $140,000 later, Cotton Belt number 819 moved under her own power for the first time since 1953, on April 6, 1986, and the crowd that had gathered at the Pine Bluff shops, including a number of Cotton Bell employees, burst into applause. On April 26th, the 819 ran her first excursion from Pine Bluff to Fordyce, Arkansas. In her first year of service alone, the locomotive had run trips for the sesquicentennial of the state of Arkansas, played a role in the movie End of the Line, and attracted huge crowds of people to Pine Bluff. In 1990, the 819 traveled to St. Louis, Missouri, to participate in that year's National Railway Historical Society convention, along with Union Pacific No. 844, Frisco No. 1522, and Norfolk and Western No. 1218. Unfortunately, her time in the spotlight was to be brief. The locomotive only ran for another 3 years after this, her last run being an excursion to Tyler, Texas. Today, the 819 still sits dormant at the Pine Bluff shops, now home to the Arkansas Railroad Museum. A restoration is allegedly taking place, but is currently progressing at a snail's pace, as numerous other projects hamper the effort. Perhaps one day, the 819 will see steam again, but as of now, she lies silent in the shops where she first saw life. Number 3, Southern Railway, number 722. This consolidation type was built in 1904 by the Baldwin Locomotive Works of Philadelphia for the Southern Railway. For 48 years, the locomotive was used mostly on the Southern's Murphy branch until her retirement from freight service in 1952. Rather than being cut up, however, the 722 and one of her sisters, number 630, were bought by the East Tennessee and Western North Carolina Railroad and renumbered to 208 and 207 respectively. Following the purchase, the Southern made a few modifications to the engines to make them more acclimated to their new venue, including cutting down the size of the coal bunkers to give the engineers a better view during reverse operation and switching. For the next 15 years, the two Southern sisters worked together on the 11-mile short line until 1967, when both were traded back to the Southern Railway to take part in their steam excursion program, with 282 Mikado number 4501 and 462 Pacific number 750. Both were given back their original numbers, and number 630 was put into service first, as 722 had a crack in her firebox that needed to be repaired. The 722 entered excursion service for the Southern in 1970, painted in the Southern Sylvan green and gold paint scheme to match the 4501. The locomotive was loaned out twice during her excursion career, the first in 1979 to the Wilmington and Western Railroad of Delaware, and then again in 1980 to the Tennessee Valley Railroad Museum in Chattanooga, along with number 630. At the same time, the need for these two little engines was shrinking, as the steam program expanded to require larger locomotives, including Texas and Pacific number 610 and Chesapeake and Ohio number 2716, among others. The 722 would last see service in 1985, when her flute time expired, and was placed on display at the museum. In 1992, the successor to the Southern Railway, the Norfolk Southern, moved number 722 to Asheville, North Carolina, to be placed on static display. Just 7 years later, NS sold the property for the city to redevelop it, and moved 722 again to the Asheville Roundhouse for cold storage. The following year, the locomotive was purchased by the Great Smoky Mountains Railroad, which happens to operate over the former Southern's Murphy branch, the same place where number 722 saw revenue freight service. The Great Smoky Mountains Railroad operates another 280 of U.S. Transportation Corps heritage, number 1702, occasionally throughout the year. Locomotives number 630 and 4501 from the steam program both still operate excursions at the Tennessee Valley Railroad Museum, and number 750 is sitting proudly on display at the Southeastern Railway Museum in Duluth, Georgia. Unfortunately, the 722 might not be as lucky. Today, she remains disassembled outside the Great Smoky Mountain Railroad's shops in Dillsboro, North Carolina, with an uncertain future. There are currently no plans to return the 722 to service, but the estimated cost of the restoration is $700,000. Number 2, London and Northeastern, number 4468, Mallard. This impressive Pacific was built by the LNER's own Doncaster Works, rolling out of the shops on March 3, 1938. Designed by Nigel Gresley, Mallard and her 34 sisters were designed with aerodynamic streamlining, and potentially had the ability to rocket down the rails at over 100 miles an hour. Although they would rarely reach this speed in revenue service, those that were assigned to trains like the Coronation and the Silver Jubilee did achieve such a pace on several occasions. On July 3, 1938, just 4 months after being built, Mallard would prove the class's reliability and speed, and make railroad history. That day, Mallard was assigned to the East Coast Line, being used on a brake test, as the locomotive coasted down Stoke Bank, passing milepost 90 and a quarter, Mallard was recorded at an astounding 126 miles per hour. This officially made Mallard the fastest steam locomotive in the entire world. Although many people continue to question this run and claim that others were faster, this record was later officially proven by Nigel Gresley himself. When the four largest railway companies in England, including the London and Northeastern, were consolidated into British Railways in 1948, number 4468 was renumbered to number 60,022. The locomotive was in service for another 25 years, earning her retirement in 1963. Of 35 A4s built, Mallard was one of six engines to survive, with two of them being shipped overseas for preservation. These were number 60,008, Dwight D. Eisenhower, and number 60,010, Dominion of Canada. Mallard was donated to the National Railway Museum in York, where she sat for another 23 years. Fortunately, this railroad legend would see a second life in preservation. In the mid-1980s, the locomotive was pulled out of the museum and restored to operating condition, as the 50th anniversary of her record was quickly approaching. From 1986 to 1988, Mallard galloped along the rails of England once again, further proving the class's reliability and attracting a crowd in the process. However, after the 1988 season, Mallard was retired once more and placed back on display. The last major event that Mallard was a part of was from 2012 to 2014, when all six surviving A4 Pacifics were reunited in England, with two of them coming from the United States and Canada for the events. Today, Mallard still rests at the National Railway Museum in York, being one of the museum's most popular attractions. She stands proudly as a testament to the class's reliability and speed, and the record she set over eight decades ago still has not been broken to this day. One can hope that she will see steam again someday, but for now, the fastest steam locomotive in the world stands still. Number 1, Canadian Pacific, number 1278. This mighty Pacific was built by the Canadian Locomotive Company in 1948 for the Canadian Pacific Railway. Something of note in the design of the locomotive is that it does not have a steam dome. Instead, the Canadian Pacific opted for a different throttle design that did not require one. The locomotive was retired from revenue freight service in the early 1960s and was purchased by F. Nelson Blount for a Steamtown USA collection in 1965, along with two sister engines and renumbered to 127. Because the engine was Blount's favorite, he decided she would be the one to receive the Steamtown beauty treatment. Changes included a change in the feed water heater system, an addition of a pile headlight with a visor, and a smoke box mounted bell. The locomotive would shortly begin hauling excursions for Steamtown, for Michigan's Cadillac and Lake City Railroad, and for Ross Rowland's High Iron Company. The locomotive number was restored to 1278 in 1973. After Steamtown's move to Scranton, Pennsylvania in the 1980s, the 1278 was traded to the Gettysburg Railroad in exchange for Canadian National number 3254. Unfortunately, during her time on the Gettysburg, maintenance on the locomotive was badly deferred, and the engine crews were not properly trained on steam locomotive maintenance and operation. What the crews were doing was outright illegal, and the punishment was to be deadly. Friday, June 16th, 1995, began as what seemed to be a normal day on the Gettysburg Railroad, except for one small issue. Earlier in the day, the crews noted a leaky check valve on number 1278, and in response, the firemen shut off the feed water pump. The locomotive seemed to be operating just fine afterward, with the water glass appearing to operate the way it should. Unfortunately, looks were deceiving. Shortly after 7 p.m., on the head of a dinner train carrying approximately 300 people, the crew allowed the water level in the 1278's boiler to drop below the minimum level, allowing the crown sheet to overheat and fail. Suddenly, scalding hot steam swarmed the cab as the boiler exploded, severely burning all three crew members riding. A National Transportation Safety Board investigation revealed the crew's wrongdoings in maintenance. Among many other issues, the spindle was revealed to have almost been completely clogged with scale. This caused the glass to display a water level that was much higher than that in the boiler. Fortunately, a design technicality in the firebox prevented a more severe explosion, so while the crew did suffer second and third degree burns, at least they escaped the accident alive. In 1998, much of the former Gettysburg equipment was sold, including 1278, which was bought by none other than Jerry Joe Jacobson. Today, the 1278 enjoys a quiet retirement at the Age of Steam Roundhouse in Sugar Creek, Ohio. Despite the accident, the engine is allegedly restorable and could be made safely and reliably operational. But for now, she sits and waits. Finally come to the end of our list of the top 10 retired steam excursion stars. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.